on CA Ovary and CA Vulva. So for this, we have Dr. Reshmi and Dr. Premila as our coordinators. Dr. Reshmi,
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Please take over. Dr. Reshmi is the
Thank you, Kunimadi.
Professor at Government Medical College, Thrissur, and Dr. Premila is working as professor at Amala Medical College, Thrissur. Over
Thank you,
to
sir.
the coordinators, please.
Sir, shall I share my screen?
Yeah, please.
So, before wasting much time, after the wonderful session on CA Endometrium and the Vulva, we will go on to CA Ovary. For chairing the session, I would like to invite Dr. Nishi Roshni and Dr. Anush Kattukaran to chair the session on CA Ovary. Dr. Anush is
Yeah, I'm here.
the professor and head of department gynecology, Amala Institute of Medical Science, Thrissur. And he did his post graduation from CMC Vellore, and his area of interest is gyne oncology. Pramila?
Yes. Good evening. Welcome, Nishi Madam, to co-chair this session. Nishi Madam, she's an additional professor at Obstetrics and Gynecology at Government Medical College, Thrissur. She's the current president of Thrissur Obstetrics and Gynecology, vice president IMA, and vice president of Diabetic Club. Over to the chairpersons to handle the session. And may I request Anuj sir to call upon the first speaker, Dr. Ajit, who happens to be my classmate also. Over to the chairpersons.
Thank you, Dr. Pramila and Dr. Reshmi, for introducing us. We are starting a session on carcinoma of the ovary, and the topics lined up for the discussion are quite good and not the ones which have been discussed. It will be useful for the PGs. Anyway, it's my great pleasure to welcome Dr. Ajit Sebastian, who's from my alma mater, for this first talk in this session on germ cell tumors. Dr. Sebastian is finished his MD and has finished his fellowship in gynae oncology and is an associate professor in the Department of Gynecology Oncology at Christian Medical College, Vellore. I welcome Dr. Ajit to start his session.
Am I audible? Thank you so much for this introduction. At the onset itself, let me thank the committee for this letting me give a small talk on this germ cell ovaries. So I'll share my screen.
Dr. Ajit, I think you can remove the virtual background.
Okay, 1 minute. I don't know how to do that, but
Anyway, you can see, please. No issues.
Can you see the screen?
Yeah,
Yes.
please.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
Can you come? Okay.
Okay, so the topic given to me is germ cell tumor classification and management of a 15-year-old girl with this germinoma. So before I go into the germ cell tumor classification, let's go into the case itself. So here is a girl who's 15-year-old, a class 11th student who presents to a general OPD with a month-old history of abdominal distension. Cycles are regular, and on general examination, everything is within normal limits. When you're doing a abdominal examination, there's a mass around 15 into 10 centimeters in the left iliac fossa, which is mobile, non-tender, firm in consistency, with all the margins being well appreciated. There is no free fluid on percussion, and on the PR, there's no nodularity which is felt in the pouch of Douglas. So the questions are, what is the diagnosis? How will you proceed with this patient? And how will you manage a patient like this? So the differentials in this age group can be benign as well as malignant. So the benign ones can be any functional cyst, follicular, corpus luteal, or the epithelial ovarian cysts. The malignant counterparts are the epithelial ovarian malignancies, germ cell tumors, and sex cord stromal tumors. So because this is a 15-year-old girl with a very short history, the first and foremost diagnosis should be a germ cell. So what is germ cell? Ovarian germ cell tumors are from the primordial germ cells of the ovary, and they may be benign or malignant, which comprise approximately 20-25% of all the ovarian neoplasms. And 5% of this accounts for the malignant ovarian neoplasms. So ovarian germ cell tumors arise primarily in very young women between the age of 10 to 30 and represent 70% of the ovarian neoplasms in this age group. What are the general symptoms? Abdominal enlargement, the mass itself, or if there is ascites, both can cause it, abdominal enlargement. Abdominal pain may be because of the rupture or torsion of the cyst. If the HCG is very high, they can present with precocious puberty or abnormal vaginal bleeding. And symptoms of pregnancy because of the HCG production also can be there. So when you investigate a patient with early young age with an ovarian mass, the tumor, role of tumor markers. So there are some tumor markers which are elevated in germ cell tumors are the alpha fetoprotein, beta HCG, and the LDH. Imaging, ultrasound, abdomen, pelvis will suffice if clinically the mass is very mobile and your tumor markers are not very elevated, and ultrasound, abdomen, and pelvis will suffice, will tell us which ovary is enlarged and what all disease she has. But if there is massive ascites and the mass is immobile, the tumor markers are elevated, then you know to know whether the what is the stage of the disease and should like to do a CT abdomen and a pelvis. So here's a image of an ultrasound abdomen of an dysgerminoma, where you can see normally this germ cell tumors are solid. So this is a solid ovarian mass with some cystic component around it. This is a similar picture. This is a CT imaging of, again, a dysgerminoma, where you can see the solid areas as well as the cystic component of that. And what are the other investigations for? Because you're planning to prepare the patient for a surgery, you would like to do a CBC profile, a liver function test, creatinine, blood-borne viral screening, and a chest X-ray to look for any metastasis outside the abdomen. Management, yeah, the treatment principles for germ cell ovaries of the are similar to the epithelial ovarian. Surgery is the required for diagnosis, staging, and as well as treatment. So germ cell tumors should undergo a thorough exploration of the abdomen with complete surgical staging for apparent early stage and an optimal cytoreduction for metastatic disease when it is safe and feasible. One thing about germ cell tumors are that they are generally present in a very early stage, and most of them are at stage one. And they are very highly sensitive to platinum-based chemotherapy. Now coming to the topic about the classification, germ cell tumor is basically primordial germ cell is divided into primitive germ cell. The primitive germ cell tumor is a dysgerminoma, and the other one is undifferentiated germ cell. The undifferentiated germ cell can be embryonal or extra-embryonal. And from the embryonal, you have the mature teratoma, which is the benign counterpart of germ cell tumor, then immature teratoma. And extra-embryonal are the trophoblasts from trophoblast or the yolk sac. So trophoblast is the choriocarcinoma of the ovary, and from the yolk sac is the endodermal sinus tumor or embryonal carcinomas. So coming to dysgerminoma, they are more likely to be localized to the ovary at the diagnosis, and 2/3 of the cases are present in stage one. The bilateral involvement is very, very common with dysgerminoma. It's almost approximately 10-15%, and it generally spreads in a very predictable fashion, and it is very sensitive to radiation therapy. On histology, the neoplasm is composed of undifferentiated germ cells, large vesicular cells with clear cytoplasm, well-defined cell boundaries, and centrally placed regular nuclei. So the overall appearance is sometimes described as resembling a fried egg. The stroma is infiltrated by clusters of small lymphocytes and frequently contains granulomas. So here's a histological picture of a dysgerminoma where you can see the nucleus and the vacuole. Grossly, dysgerminoma appears as a lobulated mass that is firm and cream-colored or pale tan. And generally, these dysgerminomas develop within a gonadoblastoma in phenotypic females who have a Y chromosomes. That's why when you find a ovarian mass in a very young patient, you should do a phenotype of the genetic of the makeup of the patient to know whether they are phenotypically females or not. This is a picture of an ovarian dysgerminoma. Okay, what are the clinical manifestations? The growth of dysgerminomas is usually very rapid, and as a result, patient often presents with abdominal enlargement and pain due to rupture with hemoperitoneum or torsion, and can have menstrual abnormalities because if the tumor is hormonally active. This germinoma generally contains cincture trophoblastic giant cells that produce placental alkaline phosphatase and lactate dehydrogenase. So when you're doing a tumor marker for this germinoma, the LDH and PLAP should be done. And serial measurements of these markers can be useful for monitoring the disease or for follow-up of these patients. 3-5% of this germinomas can produce human chorionic gonadotrophins also. So as I already said that 2/3 or 75% of all the women with this germinoma is present in the early stage, and the contralateral ovary is involved in approximately 10-15%. So bilateral ovarian disease is very more commoner with this germinoma than any other counterpart of the germ cell tumors. Management, surgery is required for the diagnosis, staging and treatment. And as with epithelial ovarian cancers, these patients should undergo a thorough exploration of the abdomen with surgical staging. And because these tumors occur in a very young age group, fertility sparing surgeries can also be done. So staging system is similar to that of epithelial ovarian cancer, and generally malignant ovarian germ cell tumors spread via the lymphatics, bloodstream, or peritoneal surface dissemination. The standard staging procedure for ovarian cancer is total extrafacial hysterectomy with bilateral salpingographic, pelvic and paratic lymphodissection. But as I said, these germ cell tumors affect the children and adolescents and other young women. Fertility sparing surgery should be performed when it is feasible. So peritoneal cytology is collected after the incision is made. Staging, including omentectomy and cytology from the diaphragm, is needed. And as with other intra-abdominal gynecological malignancy, complete staging, including biopsies of any areas where metastasis is suspected, should be done. And cytoreduction should be performed when metastasis is evident. Role of lymphadenectomy, it depends. It is controversial, but then overall prevalence of lymph node involvement varies by histology. And it is more commoner with this germinoma, almost up to 18-28%. Whereas in mixed germ cell tumors is around 7-16%, and malignant teratomas, it's around 3-8%. Despite this importance of upfront surgical debulking, the surgeon should always keep in mind the sensitivity of these tumors to cisplatin-based chemotherapy when aggressive resection of metastatic disease is considered, particularly in patients with this germinoma. So approximately 80% of patients who present with advanced disease have still a good prognosis, even they have residual disease remaining after a cytoreductive surgery. Fertility preservation, unilateral salpingo-oophorectomy with preservation of a normal appearing uterus and contralateral ovary is an option for women with clinically apparent early stage disease. And as I already said, after chemotherapy, at least 80% of these women will resume normal menstrual function, and those who become pregnant appear to have no increase in pregnancy complications. The ipsilateral fallopian tube is removed because of the rich lymphovascular connections between the tube and the ovary, and oncological outcomes are not compromised by conservative surgery even in face of bulky metastatic disease anywhere else in the body. The risk of occult contralateral ovarian involvement appears to be great with this germinomas. So previously, routinely, some surgeons used to do a wedge resection of a normally appearing contralateral ovary, but this is not universally accepted because these are very highly chemosensitive tumors. So unnecessary surgery on a normal ovary, even a biopsy, should be avoided because it can cause postoperative adhesions and can impair her fertility later on. But if bilateral salpingo oophorectomy is required, women with a uterus but no ovaries can become pregnant using egg ovum donor or their own cryopreserved fertilized eggs or ovarian tissue or oocytes can be done. What is the adjuvant therapy and when do you give adjuvant therapy? Adjuvant therapy is reserved for, except for stage 1A and 1B dysgerminoma, all the other stages of dysgerminoma should be treated with adjuvant chemotherapy, and there are multiple platinum based regimens including BEP, etoposide and cisplatin, etoposide carboplatin. The commonly used regimen is bleomycin, etoposide and cisplatin. If you are giving, then you have to give it for 3 cycles, once in every 21 days. But because of the pulmonary fibrosis caused by bleomycin, some people don't use bleomycin, then it has to be etoposide and cisplatin, which is given for 4 cycles. Prognosis, the 5-year survival rate, it's very good. Even with a stage 1C disease or an early stage disease, it is up to 100%. Stage 2, it comes down to 85%. Stage 3, 79%. And stage 4 is 71%. Post-treatment surveillance, most recurrences develop within the first 2 years of initial therapy, and the optimal post-treatment surveillance strategy has not yet been established, but a reasonable strategy include the following, like tumor markers like alpha-fetoprotein, HCG should be repeated regularly. And according to the RCOG guidelines, you should do once in every 2 weeks, you should repeat the tumor markers for this patient. The review of symptoms and physical examination should be done every 2 to 4 months for the first 2 years, followed by annual visits every year. Radiographic imaging every 2 to 4 months for the first 2 years, only in patients whose initial tumor markers levels are not elevated. What are the post-treatment issues? Premature menopause. Most women who receive platinum-based therapy for 3 to 4 cycles generally recover into normal ovarian function, but premature menopause has been reported in women who have previously received chemotherapy. The importance of pre-treatment counseling and planning to ensure that most appropriate treatment is rendered, taking into account the age of the patient and her desires regarding future fertility, should be done. Secondary malignancies. An important cause of late morbidity and mortality in patients undergoing treatment for germ cell is a development of secondary malignancies, which can be both solid as well as leukemia. And etoposide is very particular risk-related dose, has a very high risk-related dose to cause leukemia. This is the RCOG guidelines to follow up the patient surveillance of patients with stage 1A ovarian germ cell tumors. So as I said, you have to do tumor markers. If it's a dysgerminoma, you have to be done for the first 6 months, every 2 weekly, you have to do the tumor markers. So the take home message from this is ovarian germ cell tumors occur predominantly in children and young women. Fertility sparing surgery is a possibility. And for women who have completed family, hysterectomy is not contraindicated. And the recommended adjuvant chemotherapy of choice is bleomycin, etoposide, and cisplatin. And all women should be followed by history and physical examination, serum tumor markers, and radiographic tests after the completion of treatment for ovarian germ cell tumors. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Ajit, for that crisp class on germ cell tumors. I think the emphasis should be given to fertility sparing surgeries because these patients belong to this younger age group. And of course, you have pointed out about the future fertility in spite of doing fertility sparing surgery and the problem of secondary malignancies in these children. I think that is also important when we counsel these patients. Thank you for your excellent talk, Dr. Ajit.
Yeah, thank you so much.
Thank you, Dr. Ajit. Can you please stop the screen sharing?
Yes, it's stopped.
Yeah.
I request Nishi Madam to introduce our next speaker, Dr. Lakshmi.
Thank you. Am I audible?
Yes, ma'am. Yes.
So first of all, let me thank Dr. Kunjumoideen and the team for giving a chance to become the part of this excellent webinar for the postgraduates. And I'm happy to invite Dr. Lakshmi Haridas, who will enlighten us on the chemotherapy in ovarian malignancies. Dr. Lakshmi is the assistant professor in the Department of Medical Oncology, RCC, Trivandrum. Over to you, madam, for the session.
Thank you. Myself is Dr. Lakshmi. I've been new to this audience and I thank the organizers for giving me this opportunity. Am I audible?
Yes.
Dr. Lakshmi, am I
yes,
audible?
Doctor. Yes, Dr. Lakshmi, go ahead.
Please
you can start sharing your screen now.
Please pardon with me if I take 5 more minutes for the talk. Yeah, is it visible?
Yes, you can have a screen sharing also. I mean, slideshow. Yes, it's okay. Go ahead.
So this is, I understand this is a PG audience, this is a PG session. So we'll discuss the basics on chemotherapy. What are the principles? Just to touch the basics, what are the agents used? And of course, role in carcinoma ovary. By the previous sessions, I understand that the PGs are very knowledgeable and they have already know what are the basics and all this. So to get, just keep the audience alert, this is the magic bullet idea. And this is based on the findings of Paul Ehrlich, who is often called the father of chemotherapy, but he has not found any chemotherapeutic agents. He was a microbiologist who was interested in staining properties of bacteria. And what he found out was that in the tubercle bacillus, he reported the acid-fast specific clogging of acid-fast nature. So he was in search for a treatment for syphilis, and he discovered something called a salvarsan, which is an arsenic derivative, which was called the first magic bullet. And he thought, his thought was, why, if the bacteria can specifically accumulate a stain, why not use this specificity therapeutically, so that if you use a bacteria toxic agent, the bacteria can concentrate it, and if it happens to be toxic, so the bacteria will be killed. At the same time, spare in the normal tissues also. That thought gave rise to the new branch of medicine, chemotherapy. Side by side, lot of luck, trial and error, and all empiricism have worked for the discovery of all agents, what we have now, except the targeted agents and the immunological agents. The secret gas program in the USA in the Second World War has made us learn a lot, and the discarded toxins were later proven to be a source of anti-cancer agents. So that led to the current discovery of multiple chemotherapeutic agents. Regarding carcinoma ovary, there are various scenarios where we discuss chemotherapy. Yeah, in CO ovary, we need to know about the second and third terms, that is neoadjuvant chemotherapy and adjuvant chemotherapy. Primary induction chemotherapy basically works for leukemias. There is no role in ovarian malignancy. So neoadjuvant chemotherapy is something that is given after you get a histological diagnosis of malignancy, but before a definite surgical therapy. It is to expose the distant metastasis and the local disease to your effective chemotherapy upfront, so that you get the tumor debulked, and also you will get the in vivo assessment of the tumor biology, whether the tumor is responding to chemo or not. Adjuvant chemotherapy is something which we give after the patients have got an initial local therapy, and via local treatment, we have removed all the evidence of disease, but they are at a high rate of recurrence. So to tackle those micrometastases, we would be giving adjuvant chemotherapy. So this is in nutshell how a cell goes, G1, S, G2, and M. So there are various classes of drugs which are cell cycle specific. We'll be now concentrating on our area. This is the taxane, which we usually give in CO ovary. And this is cisplatin and carboplatin. So the red and the green ones are cell cycle specific. This taxanes act in the M phase, and the carboplatin, cisplatin, and bleomycin, which we will discuss, will be acting on G1, G2, and S phase. They will be called the alkylating agents. So in ovary, we use many of the solid malignancies, we use combination chemotherapy. Why don't we use a single agent, why don't we use a single agent, and why do we go for a combination chemotherapy? That is because you want different mechanisms of action to work together, and the individual agent should be active against the tumor against which we are aiming treatment. They should be synergistic in action. They should not antagonize themselves. They should have distinct resistance pattern, because, for example, if you are doing a combination drug A and B, A has the same resistance mechanisms as B, there is no point in giving it continuously. So you choose drugs with different resistance patterns and minimal overlapping of toxicity. So this is a basic diagram which all PGs should know. This is the time, this is the time frame, and this is the tumor cell burden in our body. So imagine this is a healthy person. Slowly the cancer cells build up in your body. It becomes 10 raised to 6, that is 1 milligram mass. We will not know it. Slowly, it again goes undetected. It grows into a 1 gram mass, which is equal to 10 raised to 9 cells. At that bad point, the patient will become symptomatic. The patient will come to you with a problem. You diagnose the disease. If the patient is amenable for surgery, you do the surgery. You get the tumor bulk come down, and then you give chemotherapy so that you will aim at a curative level of tumor cells. If the patient can't go for surgery, they go for chemotherapy. So when you give one cycle of chemotherapy, there will be a 3 log reduction. While waiting for the next cycle of chemotherapy, and on an average, say 3 weeks time, the tumor will regrow. That is 1 to 2 logs, depending on each person. So that is why we schedule our chemotherapies at regular intervals. And this is how you can count the peaks. It is 6. That is why this magic number of 6 had come. So you give the chemo, pull the tumor load down. It goes up, then pull down. It goes up, then pull down. And that is how you aim at a cure. If the patient does not respond to the chemotherapy, they'll progress and ultimately end up in a terminal phase. So in ovarian malignancies, we'll be dealing on epithelial ovarian cancers and germ cell tumors. So from now onwards, we'll be dealing with two terms, progression-free survival and overall survival. the patient presents to you with a symptom. You get a diagnosis, you start treatment here, you end the treatment here, then you'll be followed and the patient will have a recurrence here. So from the diagnosis till recurrence, this is called a progression-free survival. And you again treat, there'll be multiple lapses, you treat, and then ultimately the patient will end up in death. So from the diagnosis till death, this is the overall survival. In oncology, all the trials will be looking at the overall survival benefit. Some drugs or some procedures, whatever be there, will have a progression-free survival also. But it is clinically meaningful for a patient. But in general terms, overall survival is what is aimed by any trial. So this is, I'm skipping it due to want of time. So ovarian cancers, again, you know, epithelial 90%. Among epithelial, you have the serous histology 70%. So as you have already discussed, the standard of care for the early stage ovarian cancer is staging laparotomy followed by adjuvant chemo. For the advanced stage, again, neoadjuvant followed by interval cytoreduction and then adjuvant chemotherapy. So why do you do a cytoreduction? That is the aim. You should aim at complete cytoreduction of all microscopic visible disease. Previously, it was OCR. Now it is complete cytoreduction. No visible disease should be left behind. So what are the theoretical benefits? As we discussed earlier, you're removing large necrotic masses so that with tumors with a good supply you want, and so that the drug delivery will be maximum. You're again removing the resistant clones, and leftover tiny implants will have a higher growth fraction, which should be more chemosensitive. That is a basic principle when you are giving chemotherapy. If you have a large tumor, growth fraction will be low, the chemo won't act. If you have a tiny leftover, you have a higher growth fraction and the tumor will be more chemosensitive. So how do you decide which patient should go for neoadjuvant chemotherapy in CA ovary? So we have the definite guidelines as to which is resectable versus unresectable. You have a if you have a mesenteric infiltration of the root of mesentery, you don't like her to be operated first. Diffuse carcinomatosis amounting to short bowel syndrome, if a surgery is done, you don't want to operate. Infiltration of major organs like stomach, duodenum, pancreas, no. Parenchymal, liver mets, or lung mets, brain mets, no. So there is again Lewen criteria. This I think all may be familiar with. So you put the patient on neoadjuvant chemotherapy. So what are the benefits of chemotherapy? This is a very important question. Benefits of neoadjuvant chemotherapy are, we are increasing the chances of getting an OCR at surgery by debulking the tumor. You have a dry operative field, you have a decreased tumor burden, less extensive surgery, reduced blood loss, improved quality of life, and it is again a test of chemosensitivity. Is the advantage of neoadjuvant chemotherapy only theoretical, or if you have something else? Yes, we have evidence for that also. These are the major two trials which have looked into whether giving primary chemotherapy or primary surgery, which is better. So these are the major two trials, and the results put together in a forest plot says that advanced ovarian cancer patients with a poor GC, primary chemotherapy followed by delayed surgery is having the similar overall survival as patients treated with primary surgery. So that is how the neoadjuvant concept has come into practice. So advanced stage, is it debulkable at R0? Yes, you go for surgery and decide accordingly. If no, you give neoadjuvant chemotherapy. So we'll come to our topic proper. How did the chemotherapy in CA ovary evolve? It had all been in the 1960s with cyclophosphamide, alkaline as melphalan, radiotherapy, and slowly the science progressed till here. First of all, we'll see what is the benefit of adjuvant chemotherapy. Is there any benefit in giving adjuvant chemotherapy? Yes. If you give adjuvant chemotherapy after surgery for an early stage ovarian cancer, it has better overall survival. It has shown in this graph, this is the topmost line which gives data on patients who have received adjuvant chemotherapy and new adjuvant chemotherapy. So definitely this arm is better in overall survival and again in PFS. So based on these two trials, ICON 1 and ACTION had proven better overall survival and PFS, and that has how the postoperative adjuvant chemotherapy has been the standard of practice. But to note that completeness of surgical staging is an important independent prognostic factor. 3 versus 6 cycles, we always try to give 6 cycles, and this studies shows that serous histology benefited more with 6 and not with 3. So we have the sciences, the evidence has evolved from 1960 to around 2000 here, when the trials progressed and has shown that cisplatin, again platin plus taxane, had improved survival compared to this and this arm. So now we are going to compare cisplatin taxane versus carboplatin and taxane. So many trials have looked into how do these two combination chemotherapies work, and in nutshell, both have equivalent PFS and overall survival. Moreover, paclitaxel had more favorable toxicity profile, and that has been the preferred regimen from the date of discovery till now. That is, we will give IV paclitaxel 175 per meter square over a 3-hour infusion plus carboplatin AUC 5-6 every 3 weekly for 6 cycles. So one main toxicity of paclitaxel is peripheral neuropathy, more pronounced in patients who are diabetic. So in patients who develop neuropathy, we would change paclitaxel to another taxane drug, which is docetaxel, and give it for the rest of the 6 cycles. And other option, category 1 recommendation for upfront neoadjuvant chemotherapy or adjuvant chemotherapy has been liposomal doxorubicin plus carboplatin 6 cycles. So we have 3 standard options as of now. Neoadjuvant chemo is preferably given 3-4 cycles. There is no proven added benefit in giving more than 6 cycles. You have the option of adding bevacizumab, which is a VEGF inhibitor, along with chemo and as a maintenance, but it does not have any overall survival advantage, but it has a PFS advantage. The importance of bevacizumab is that you have to give 6-week gap with the surgery. It is a very good drug when patients present with refractory ascites, because it is a VEGF inhibitor. So the angiogenesis will come down and the vascular leak will come down, and the patient with ascites will clinically benefit. So there is something called, just a word, there is something called Dostin's chemo, which is that means instead of 3-weekly cycles, we give 2-weekly. In ovary, we do not have survival advantage of dose tensing a chemo, and people have tried to deepen the response by adding more drugs to paclitaxel, but that again has shown negative results. So treatment in a nutshell, serous histology, all high grade, please note 1A low grade, no adjuvant chemotherapy if it is a properly staged disease. For all high grade disease, adjuvant chemotherapy. In low-grade diseases, stage 1, you have the option of omitting adjuvant chemotherapy if it is a properly stage 1. From stage 2 onwards, it is adjuvant chemotherapy. Mucinous, again, 1A, grade 1 to 2, expansile, no chemo. Infiltrative type and stage 2A onwards, adjuvant chemotherapy. One thing to note in mucinous histology is that you can either give paclitaxel 6 cycles or GI protocols, like it's called FOLFOX, that is 5-FU with leucovorin and oxaliplatin. These two are the drugs, 5-FU and oxaliplatin for 6 cycles, or capecitabine, oxaliplatin. Capecitabine is an oral formulation of 5-FU, so that both 5-FU and oxaliplatin will come in the GI protocol. For mucinous ovarian carcinoma, you can give either of these regimens. So for clear cell histology, again, more than 1C2 onwards, you have to give adjuvant chemotherapy. Endometrioid, again, 1A, grade 1 to 2, no adjuvant. All high grade, whatever be the stage, give chemo. And stage 2A onwards, chemotherapy. So this is in nutshell. We just can go through this. This is the one which is the standard of care. You can also see dose tens partly written here, but we do not practice it. For elderly patients, you can reduce paclitaxel to 135 with carboplatin same dose. There are other regimens also. You can give single agent carboplatin also every 21 days for 6 cycles. And this is the protocol which includes bevacizumab, which has a PFS advantage, and maintenance bevacizumab arm, which all these two arms show bevacizumab has included drugs, but it has only a PFS advantage. So one thing to note is that here you see intraperitoneal chemotherapy. So what is the data on that? Why do we give intraperitoneal? It is because you have a concentration of the drug in the peritoneal cavity, so that the drug exposure will be high. Only thing is that it can penetrate only up to 3 millimeters. So I'm skipping this. So major trial, Armstrong et al. Have shown that if you give intraperitoneal chemotherapy, there is a prolongation of median overall survival, but the trial was associated with severe several toxicities. and only 40% of patients were able to complete all the planned 6 cycles of IP chemotherapy. That is very, very important. So that is why it has not been the standard of practice till now. But somebody wants to select a patient for intrapatural chemotherapy, it should be a stage 3 epithelial ovarian cancer patient who has no or minimal residual disease after primary surgery and who can tolerate the toxicity. That is very, very, very important. So you please avoid it in patients with renal insufficiency, baseline neuropathy, and extensive intra-abdominal adhesions. The drugs used for intrapatural chemotherapy are paclitaxel and cisplatin, and you try to give it for 6 cycles. HIPEC is a very debated topic. As per NCCN, the role of heat in HIPEC is that it is believed to augment the cytotoxic effect of the chemotherapeutic agents. And as per NCCN, HIPEC can be considered for the subgroup of patients what we have discussed earlier. So we know ovarian cancer patient, despite the treatment, whatever we give, they have a relapse, and stage 4 and 3 patients, this is the survival percentages. So after the first line of treatment, cytolytic surgery and 6 cycles of taxane, the patients will progress. You can see that if they progress first at 9 months, they would, if we give chemo, again, they have a drug-free interval and progress at shorter intervals. So gaps between the successive lines of treatment will be shorter. If a patient progresses on chemotherapy or within 3 months, it is refractory. Within 6 months, this is counted from the day of last chemotherapy. Within 6 months, it is resistant. Partially platinum sensitive is still 12 months, and more than 12 months, it is fully sensitive. So till 2015, we did not have the option of maintenance. You either wait for the patient to relapse and then treat accordingly. Now we have the option of maintenance, that is to maintain the response of whatever treatment we had given the patient earlier, that is cytoreductive surgery and response to platinum-based chemotherapy. So we have 4 groups of drugs: bevacizumab, moderate PFS benefit; paclitaxel, no role; pasopanib, only minimal PFS, we do not give it. The only thing which we now have in hand is PARP inhibitors, that are various drugs. I'll be talking on just olaparib because this is the only PARP inhibitor which is available in India as of now. So skipping all this, this is, if you have a single stranded break, this PARP1 enzyme will come and repair it. If you have a double stranded break, BRCA will come and bind it. So what will happen if both these are gone? That is what you intend by giving a PARP inhibitor. This is a normal cell. You give PARP inhibitor to a lady with a homologous recombination safe. So,
Dr. Lakshmi.
Yes.
Time is over. Running.
I'll summarize. So this, okay. PGs, please look onto this mechanism of PARP inhibitor is very important. So the trial you can give in the olaparib maintenance, you can give for 2 years, but it is very costly. We'll end up in either giving patient site reduction or systemic treatment and relapse. So germ cell tumors, as the previous speaker has said, it is adjuvant BEP. I'm going to summarize. In COVRI, you discuss the option of adjuvant chemotherapy, its theoretical benefits, neoadjuvant chemotherapy, paclitaxel 6 cycles. The same regimen is given as adjuvant and neoadjuvant. Docetaxel can be substituted if the patient develops neuropathy. Lipodoscarbo is again an option. Mucinous carcinoma, you have the option of GI protocol also. You can add bevacizumab. Maintenance with olaparib if the patients are BRCA mutated. Germ cell tumors, BEP into 3 to 4 cycles is given. At relapse, you give TIP, and high dose chemotherapy is also a treatment option. Thank you.
Thank you, Lakshmi, for that elaborate session. You have covered A to Z of chemotherapy within this short span. Due to the lack of time, I will hand over to the session to the coordinators to continue.
Yeah. Yes, ma'am. Thank you. Thank you.
I now request Dr. Anuj to introduce our next speaker, Dr. Chitradhara.
I would like to welcome Dr. Chitradhara to this PGCME on oncology. Madam is the director at the Institute of Gynec Oncology and Breast Sciences at Lakeshore Hospital in Kochi. Madam, as most of us know, is an excellent surgeon and is going to talk to us on the surgical management of ovarian cancer. Over to you, madam.
Hello.
Chittatara, are you able to?
Madam, you have to unmute, madam. Please unmute. Okay. Madam,
please unmute.
Please unmute,
madam.
I don't know whether she's listening or not.
Yes, she was.
She's there online, but.
She's there online, yes.
Hello.
Madam.
Please unmute.
Yes, I can unmute. Can you please unmute, madam?
Yeah. I unmute.
Yes. Okay.
Listen, can.
You have to share the screen.
Am I audible?
Yes, madam.
Screen
share. Screen share. Can you see my screen?
Is my screen seen?
No,
my screen
madam.
Is seen?
Not yet,
madam.
Yes, ma'am. Now it's visible.
Yeah.
Please make it into slideshow, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am.
At the outset, I thank Dr. Rashmi and the organizers for giving me this opportunity. And I'm going to talk about the surgical management of ovarian cancer. As you know, among the gynecological malignancies, ovarian cancer is the second in incidence and first being the cervical cancer. But even then, it is the deadliest among them and has got the highest case fatality rate. And it constitutes half of or more than half of a surgical burden in a gynecology unit. And regarding the surgical management, we have to divide it into early stage disease and advanced stage disease. Early stage disease, primary surgery and comprehensive staging is the standard of care. And in advanced disease, primary cytoreduction if it is operable, or we have to go for neoadjuvant chemotherapy followed by interval cytoreduction after thorough workup. And regarding early stage disease, if we want to go for a fertility sparing surgery, removal of the tumor bearing adnexia, and it has to be done without spillage, and we have to go for a comprehensive staging. And if the family is completed, can proceed to total hysterectomy and removal of the contralateral salpic ovary and then staging. And regarding the comprehensive staging, because I think most of the RPG students, I'm going a little bit detail into this. A midline incision at least 3 cm above the umbilicus has to be put, or sufficient to deliver. If we have to extend, we have to extend so as to deliver the tumor without rupture. As soon as you enter the abdominal cavity, ascites fluid or peritoneal wash cytology has to be taken and visualized all peritoneal surfaces, and suspicious area should be biopsies. If no suspicious area is seen, we have to take random biopsies from POD, paracolic gutter peritoneum, and then we have to go for a diaphragm scraping. And we have to run the intestines to see any involvement, and the tumor bearing adnexia to be removed and sent for frozen section, then proceed with the other surgery, total hysterectomy and removal of the opposite ovary. And then infracolic amniotectomy is included in the staging, then pelvic and pariatric lymph node dissection. So regarding the pariatric lymph node dissection, we have to go at least to the level of inferior mesenteric artery or preferably to the level of renal vein. I'm discussing a case with you. This is a 26-year-old housewife reported after laparoscopy for suspected ovarian tumor and she was assessed inoperable on laparoscopy, and the procedure was terminated after a biopsy. And she's married for 7 years and has one child, 18 months old. And she gave history of treatment of infertility. Her abdomen, the mass was palpable and bocillated, and it was mobile, and there was no POD deposit. On ultrasound, uterus is normal. Right ovary also, probably ultrasound showed only normal right ovary. And there was a large irregular predominantly complex cystic mass extending from the pelvis to umbilicus and left lumbar region. And CA-125 was 134, and CT scan did not show any signs of obvious signs of inoperability. So since because of this mobile mass and the CT findings, we went ahead with a laparotomy again. And there was minimal ascites on laparotomy. There was a left ovarian tumor of 12 centimeter and right ovarian tumor of 6 centimeter. And miliary nodules, tiny miliary nodules were present all over the peritoneum, maybe post-surgical. And there were enlarged right iliac nodes, and induration from there, there was extending to and involving right laparoscopic port. And procedure done, we did a complete site reduction. Here I cannot tell, it is probably a staging surgery, but we did a port excision also and complete removal of the disease at that point. And the report came as 3A disease with right port metastasis. This is the patient, and this was the bilateral tumor, the tumor on the ovarian surface you can see very well. And this was the infracoelic omentectomy. You can see the gastroepiploic artery very well. These are the short gastric arteries. And usually infracoelic omentectomy, you can go up to this, but below the colon, you can restrict below the colon also. But if there was, regarding this patient, there was some evidence of probably it was post-surgical. So we did a complete omentectomy for this patient. And this is the peritoneal disease, this right iliac fossa disease, which was extending to the right port, and right port was excised. And this is the parietic lymph node dissection. This is the vena cava. So taking the lymph nodes from the parietic region, but you can see the, I think this is the inferior mesenteric artery. During the advanced stages, our aim is to go for a complete cytoreduction. That means we have to remove all the microscopic disease, but at the same time, we have to avoid a futile laparotomy. That is a non-therapeutic laparotomy we have to avoid. So we have to go for a thorough evaluation preoperatively. And by assessing the operability, we can, the clinical examination is there, then imaging studies, PET CT is optional. Usually a sex CT is done along with the X-ray chest or a CT scan whenever it is required. Then laparoscopic assessment. And gold standard of cytoreductive surgery. Advanced stage, it is cytoreductive surgery, and early stage, it is a staging laparotomy. And gold standard of cytoreductive surgery is complete removal of microscopic tumor. And it may include splenectomy, diaphragmatic resection, liver resection. Wherever it is required for complete cytoreduction, we have to remove all diseases or intra-abdominal diseases. Visible intra-abdominal disease must be removed. The definition of optimal and suboptimal cytoreduction change in different studies. So making the comparison between them difficult. But even then, it can be divided into three groups related to patient survival. One is no microscopic disease, that is R0 resection. The other is microscopic disease up to 1 centimeter. We can call it as optimal cytoreduction. And a microscopic disease larger than 1 centimeter. And these groups, three groups, can be again referred to as complete resection, that is R0 resection, then minimal residual disease and gross residual disease. And regarding the nodal dissection in advanced stage, it is recommended to remove only enlarged nodes, because you know the Lyons trial has shown no progression-free survival advantage for complete or systematic lymphadenectomy in patients with normal lymph nodes before or during the surgery. You have to see whether the lymph nodes are normal previous perioperatively also and during the surgery. And why we have to go for a complete cytoreduction? So with no residual disease, the 5-year survival rate of 64 months is reported from GOG studies. But even the residual disease is 0.1 to 1 centimeter, it is only 35 months. And if it is 1 to 2 centimeter, it is only 20 months. So it drastically reduces from 64 months to less than 35 months. But the success of cytoreductive surgery is multifactorial. We have to take it as multifactorial, and it is surgeon dependent and also disease specific. Sometimes aggressive cytoreduction, even in a aggressive disease, may not give, biologically aggressive disease may not give good results. So many aspects are there. And when we think that it is doubtful whether to go for a primary surgery, cytoreductive surgery, so we have to think of neoadjuvant chemotherapy and versus primary surgery. So what is the evidence for that, whether neoadjuvant chemotherapy is of benefit, whether it gives similar benefit as that of primary surgery, because we are comparing the results with that of the primary surgery in all the trials. This is a URTC trial reported in 2010 and also CORUS trial reported in 2015. They are non-inferiority trials. It is proved that the survival advantage is not inferior to the result of primary cytoreductive surgery. And the Scorpion trial, which is reported in 2016, is a superiority trial that shows that neoadjuvant chemotherapy has got superior mortality outcomes and it has got a better quality of life after neoadjuvant chemotherapy and interval cytoreduction. And then we will have to decide how we will decide whether we have to go for a neoadjuvant chemotherapy or a primary surgery. So here we are using so many criteria. Clinical examination is the first one. Then CT criteria, Nelson, Dowdy, and Bristow. They were the pioneers in devising these CT criteria, but Bristow's criteria is more popular. And he has taken 8 criteria, following 8 criteria, totally 13 criteria were taken plus performance status. And 2 points were given to following 8 criteria. I'm not going into details. I'm discussing these things so that the students will be familiar with these terminologies and all studies. And 1 point is given to another 5 criteria. And these 13 criteria plus performance status is taken into consideration in predicting the index. And he proved that if the index is more than 4, there is 85% specificity is there, that is inappropriate unexploration is 15%. And sensitivity is 100%, that is unnecessary exploration came down to 0% with the Bristow CT criteria. And now there is a personalized surgical approach. Yes, devised after that a personalized surgical approach to advance brain cancer. And we are taking into consideration the clinical and radiological criteria. If it is 0 to 2, we can directly go for primary cytoreductive surgery. If it is 3 or more, we have to think whether to go for a NAC or a cytoreductive surgery. In the centers who are practicing primary cytoreductive surgery, they can go for a lab assessment and decide whether patient is suitable for a primary cytoreductive surgery. Other center, they will be going for the NAC. And intraoperatively, we have to assess the tumor burden, then peritoneal cancer index is there, then LFT surgical complexity score. And Fagoti, just to familiarize these terms, Fagoti has taken 8 disease criteria, especially omandel, peritoneal, diaphragmatic, all those intra-abdominal 8 disease sites were taken and has given scores to 0 and 2. and likelihood that patient would have a suboptimal surgical result being 100% with a predictive index score of more than 8. Here the maximum score is 40. And now there is Fagotti's modified score. Fagotti is a she, and now she has come out with a modified score. This they have taken only, she has taken only 4, diaphragmatic disease, mesenteric disease, stomach infiltration, and liver metastasis. But here is also score is up to 8. It is beyond which the cytoreduction can result in a suboptimal, or it will be a non-futile laparotomy. And then we have got the peritoneal index. This can be done preoperatively with the CT scan and peroperatively, laparoscopically or peroperatively. Here the abdomen is divided into 13 sides, and the middle, 0 is the middle part. Then we will be starting with the right hypochondrium, then coming like this to left iliac fossa, then again to right lumbar region. Total 39 scores, but if it is more than 13, it's associated with a suboptimal, more likely chance of suboptimal debulking. And now Sweden et al. Has come up with two papers published, one in 2014 and one in 2017. And in the RS2 model, a predictive score of more than 6 was indicative of 87 chance of any gross residual disease at resection. And here he has taken 3 clinical criteria and 6 radiological criteria. All 6 radiological criteria, probably 5 are regarding disease in the upper abdomen, then ascites is also there. Then clinical criteria they have taken is age more than 60 years, then CA125 more than 600, and ASI score of 3 to 4. And each location, the presence of tumor or lymphadenopathy was assessed using a 5-point scale. Is it over?
Yes, ma'am.
Madam, time is up, madam.
The time is up. Then this is a MSK Memorial Sloan Kettering algorithm. This is depend on the student criteria. It is a low risk 0 to 6 and a high risk more than 7. So high-risk patient will undergo laparoscopy, then decide on the NSCT and primary cytoreductive surgery. Then LAT complexity score is there. So in that score, aggressive cytoreductive surgery, there is no benefit in certain patients. Patients with high tumor dissemination or stage 4, poor performance status, poor nutritional status, and age more than 75 years. So these patients, you need not investigate, very thoroughly investigate for a cytoreduction. You can directly go for NSC and decide. This is a diaphragmatic resection. This is a umbilical nodule resection, then omented metastasis, then a bubble resection. Then I'll come to conclusion. Primary surgery and comprehensive staging is the standard of care in early stage ovarian cancer. Advanced stages request thorough preoperative workup to prevent a non-therapeutic laparotomy. In doubtful cases, laparoscopic scoring is done before proceeding with the debulking. Laparoscopic surgery is to be avoided in suspected ovarian cancer unless under very special circumstances. Life-threatening aggressive surgery and surgeries which compromises cure and quality of life should be discouraged. Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Chittadara, for your talk. Unfortunately, there was a little short of time, but you have emphasized the importance of optimal debulking and primary surgery, which gives the best results. Also, triple debulking doesn't mean that you take up all cases for surgery and end up with a new result surgery. The emphasis on that was quite, I think, obvious to the students. Thank you very much for your talk, ma'am.
Madam, can you please stop sharing the screen? Thank you, madam.
I request Nishi, madam, to introduce the next speaker, Dr. Anupama R.
I'm very happy to invite Dr. Anupama Rajan Babu, who is a professor in HOD Department of Gynae Oncology, Amrita Institute of Medical Science, Kerala. She will enlighten on the BRCA testing and its implications. She is a peer, she has peer-reviewed publications in various journals. She has written many chapters of various books and is a reviewer of many journals like European Journal of Obstetrics and Gynecology, International Journal of Surgical Oncology, and International Journal of Gynecology. And her field of interest is minimally invasive surgery. And she has completed over 8,000 robotic gynecology surgeries and is also a trainer for robotic surgery. And she has many awards to her credit, that is Credo Fellowship Award and Accord Fellowship Award and Best Paper Award, AGO Icon in 2012, 14, 15, and 16, and Young Doctor Fellowship, IGCS in 2014. And over to you, madam, for your session.
Thank you, madam. And thank you, organizers, for inviting me to be a part of this conference. Can I share my screen? I'm not allowed to right now. I think, Dr. Rashmi, I think you'll have to stop sharing the screen.
Go ahead, Dr.
I'm not able to share. It is showing you cannot screen share.
Yeah. Now you can share.
Yeah, thank you. So, topic given to me, thank you again. And the topic given to me is BRCA testing and its implication in ovarian cancer. I hope my screen is visible now.
Yes.
Okay. So I'll be discussing very briefly for the benefit of postgraduates about what is BRCA gene, how to test it, and what are the implications of this testing in ovarian cancer. So BRCA gene, I think very briefly, we mentioned about BRCA screen in the talk prior on chemotherapy. So BRCA gene basically repairs the double-stranded breaks in the DNA. So we know DNA, when as the cells keep on dividing, there are breaks happening within the DNA. And we have several checks and mechanisms in place to repair these breaks so that our body is maintained and mutations are reduced and we all stay healthy. So BRCA is one such gene. And if there's mutations in BRCA, it can lead to problems. And the most common mutations that we see are the BRCA1 and 2 mutations. But you remember there are hundreds of mutations available. And the most common ones are the BRCA1 and 2 mutation. BRCA1, which is seen, which is due to the 17 chromosome, BRCA1 is located in the mutation position 21, and BRCA2 is located in the long arm of chromosome 13. And these two genes comprise of part of the genes which cause the hereditary breast ovarian cancer syndrome. And looking at the risk when these genes are mutated, you know the most common, highest risk is for breast cancer, then comes ovarian cancer. So if there is a BRCA1 or 2 mutation, you have a lifetime risk of breast cancer about 60-85%. And BRCA1, if it is mutated, you have about 15-40% risk of ovarian cancer. And BRCA2 has got slightly lesser risk, maybe 13-23%, or some studies mention 15-30% risk of ovarian cancer. So this is how the BRCA works. That is why we need a normal functioning BRCA for us to be staying healthy. So when do we test for BRCA and why do we test for BRCA? So the rationale is when you are having a patient with ovarian cancer, testing for BRCA gives us certain information which will help us guide the appropriate treatment for the patient. And also it gives us information to aid in prognosis. And again, it is relevant to the family because it helps us identify the unaffected carrier so that certain preventive steps can be taken, which I'll explain later, to prevent or early detect cancers in them. So whom to test, we have a long list of people who know whom to test. But as we are concerned, we're talking about ovarian cancer, I would say BRCA testing can be done for any person with a personal history of ovarian cancer. You don't have to look into their age or a family history, because BRCA mutation is common in epithelial ovarian cancer across the risk types. You can see whether it is serous, high grade, low grade, clear cell carcinosarcoma. Most of these ovarian subtypes have BRCA mutations. So if it is a patient with ovarian cancer, you don't have to think twice. You can test, you are justified to test for BRCA in them. And what are the testings available for BRCA? We have two types of testing. One is genetic testing or germline BRCA mutation testing. And second is a somatic or tumor testing. So genetic testing, as we said earlier, BRCA can be a genetically acquired mutation. So this genetic or germline testing is to find out whether you have acquired this mutation via your genes. Because if you have genetic positive, in addition to having this breast and ovarian cancer, you can have other cancers, like your family members can have implications of male breast cancer, a prostate cancer, and there's a slight increased risk of pancreatic cancer and melanoma, especially with BRCA2. But somatic or tumor testing is to detect whether the mutation is seen within the tumor. So this is important, because even if you are not carrying a BRCA mutation, you have not inherited a mutation via genetics, the tumor might sometimes show a change. And this is important because these tumors respond to platinum chemotherapy well. They have targeted therapy available. So somatic tumor testing is also important. So how to detect? We have got next generation sequencing technique with multi-gene panels to detect all these genes. We can detect BRCA alone, but usually these panels check for all a panel of genes which can cause this hereditary cancer and also cause a homologous recombinant deficiency. The somatic and this genetic testing is germline testing is done with a blood sample. The somatic testing is done from a tumor tissue. The DNA is extracted from the tumor tissue for somatic testing. And the pathologist should verify that the DNA extracted is from the tumor tissue. And again, the testing is done with NGS. When the results are given, you get results. Are they pathogenic, likely pathogenic? Sometimes we get a report of variant of uncertain significance. Sometimes we get a report of benign. So 90% we get either it's pathogenic or benign, and sometimes 10% chance we'll get a variant of uncertain significance. And these variants of uncertain significance are certain rare BRCA mutations, which may be significant, but we don't have much information about that. About 30 to 40% of them may be pathogenic. And one important thing when you're sending any patient for BRCA testing, the part of genetic counseling. It's very important for the patient who is sent for BRCA testing to understand that why is she doing this test? How this heredity is contributing to the cause and progress of her disease, progression of her disease, and this test, what this test is going to give her regarding her preventive steps or her next treatment steps. And we also should be helping her to choose a course of action and helping her to make a best adjustment to the disorder. And the pre-test, it involves pre-test counseling, detailed history of family, and when you get the result, a risk communication with the patient. And again, as analysis after the communication, a posted counseling session is also required for the patient to understand whether the patient has understood all the implications. So what are the implications of this germline mutations in the germline or tumor mutations in the management of ovarian cancer? So I don't have to tell in detail about how ovarian cancer kills women. In India also, it is the gynecological cancer with maximum mortality. And we all know ovarian cancer has got different molecular subtypes. And we know now the term ovarian, instead of the term ovarian cancer, maybe a better term would be something else, because now the serous carcinomas of the ovary, fallopian tube and primary peritoneum are best described with the term extrauterine high-grade serous carcinomas. Because we know the origin, it might not be ovary, it could be the stick cells from the fallopian tube. Similarly, endometrioid carcinoma and clear cell carcinoma, also the origins are different. And the BRCA is mostly associated with this high-grade serous carcinoma. And when you take total ovarian cancer in total, you can say approximately 10% of the ovarian cancers could be hereditary. And out of this 10% of hereditary ovarian cancers, about 90% of them, now 95% of them are due to mutations in the BRCA genes. And the BRCA genes, when you look at high-grade serous ovarian cancers alone, you can see that BRCA genes are contributing to more percentage. Like now you can see that about 30% of serous ovarian cancers are caused by BRCA mutations. Unlike when you take total ovarian cancer, only 10% were due to BRCA genetic mutations. And ovarian cancer, we still have a lot of unmet medical needs. So we listened to how chemotherapy evolved in ovarian cancer. And still with this evolved chemotherapy, we had a dismal survival in advanced stages. And we know most of them presents in advanced stages. And compared to West India, the overall survival is much less. So we needed novel therapies in addition to the traditional platinum-based chemotherapy that we were offering. Here came the PARP inhibitors, all the poly-ADP ribose polymerase inhibitors. So I think the previous speaker also mentioned about PARP inhibitors, and she mentioned how it works. She mentioned how the single cell repair is done by the PARP inhibitors, the single strand break is repaired by the PARP inhibitors, and the double strand breaks are repaired by the BRCA. So when you have a BRCA mutated cells and you're giving a PARP inhibitor to the patient, the DNA breakage, which is caused by the chemotherapy, is going to be not repaired by the abnormal cancer cells. But when you have a normal cells with the normal BRCA gene, that repair, double-stranded DNA break repair will happen, but the BRCA deficient cancer cells will not be able to repair itself. That results in a synthetic lethality and cell death. So usage of PARP inhibitors in clinical practice is prevalent across the world now for epithelial ovarian cancers. Unfortunately for India, the cost of PARP inhibitors are really prohibitive, which is limiting its use in our day-to-day clinical practice. But to know, postgraduates should know that PARP inhibitors is a part of epithelial ovarian cancer treatment now. It can be used as a first-line maintenance. That is, after you finish your chemotherapy and surgery and your neoadjuvant surgery, adjuvant chemotherapy, then you can use PARP inhibitors as a first-line maintenance, or you can use it in the sense. These two names of PARP inhibitors you should remember is a olaparib. At least you should remember the name of olaparib. I'll finish in a few minutes. And another thing which you have to mention is a risk management of the patient who's unaffected carrier of BRCA mutation. So the best risk management is prophylactic surgery to reduce the risk of breast cancer, prophylactic bilateral mastectomy. And for reducing the risk of ovarian cancer, it is salpingo-oophorectomy. The age of salpingo-oophorectomy differs between BRCA1 and BRCA2. That is something PG should remember. And salpingectomy is not the standard of care now. It is still experimental. And there are lifestyle modification and breast cancer screening awareness in these patients, which we can recommend. Ovarian screening has got limited benefit. Chemo prevention has got limited benefit. And other cancers also we can do. But again, we don't have data yet. Reproductive counseling is very important at this age, because it is an autosomal dominant inheritance and 50% chance that a carrier can have a children with a child with a BRCA mutation. So PGD can be used in this scenario to reduce that risk. To summarize, BRCA mutation testing has got therapeutic and preventive implications in ovarian cancer. You test it with NGS for germline or somatic mutations, and all patients with ovarian cancer are eligible for BRCA testing. And this is the lady who brought the BRCA testing and the risk reduction surgeries to the forefront. And because of her coming out with it, a lot of patients benefited. Thank you.
Thank
you. It's a huge topic. Sorry that I took an extra time, but it's very difficult to limit it within 10 minutes.
Thank you for that.
For the benefit of the PGs, can you mention where BRCA testing is available in Kerala?
BRCA testing is done by different labs across Kerala. There are labs which do BRCA testing. So if there are labs like MedGenome, OnQuest, so they'll collect blood and they'll do the testing, and within 2 to 3 weeks, you'll get back the results. Cost is between 15,000 to 25,000, depending upon the number of genes that you're testing. Across India now, BRCA testing is available everywhere.
Thank you.
Thank you for that clear presentation, that bringing up that for any ovarian tumor, you can do BRCA testing, especially in serous, high-grade serous epithelial tumors. And that very clearly defined that germline mutations are checked for the risk of having the disease. And then somatic tests for especially treatment, especially this BRCA, we are PARP inhibitors are very useful in BRCA mutated cells. And that prophylactic sulfangiofurectomy in BRCA1 has to be done by 35, 40 years. And BRCA2, you can wait up to 40 to 45 years. And that chemo prevention is not much useful in BRCA tumors. Thank you so much.
I request Nishi Madam to introduce the next speaker also, Dr. Betsy Thomas.
Betsy Thomas is the principal and professor of OBG department, Amila Institute of Medical Sciences, Trichy. She's a very good academician and a very good organizer who has organized previous all Kerala conferences, and also she was the past president of Trichur OBG Society. Over to you, Betsy, for Meigs syndrome.
Respected teachers, colleagues from all over the country and dear postgraduates, and thank you team POGS and coordinators for this opportunity, and thank you so much chairpersons also. Meigs syndrome, if you go back to the history, in 1852, Blinn published the description of an ovarian fibroma with abdominal effusion. In 1934, that's almost a century back, Salmon described the association of pleural effusion with benign pelvic tumors. And it was in 1937, Joe Vincent Meigs, an American professor at the Harvard Medical School, drew widespread attention to this syndrome, that's Meigs syndrome. He described 7 cases of ovarian fibromas associated with ascites and pleural effusion. So it is a favorite question during our undergraduate and postgraduate exams. That may be the reason why this is put into this program, though it's not a malignancy as such. So it is a syndrome which consists of the triad of ovarian fibroma, ascites, and pleural effusion, which is usually more on the right than the left. And for the postgraduates, the mnemonic is FAR: fibroma, ascites, and right pleural effusion. So this is the picture. It's a solid tumor, and usual differential diagnosis will be Brenner, granulosa cell tumors, and other solid tumors. And in this chest X-ray, you can see it is a right-sided hydropneumothorax. And this picture shows everything. We have got the ovarian tumor, the fibroma here, the ascites, as well as the right-sided pleural effusion. And that makes it Meigs syndrome. Let us take one by one. Fibroma. Fibromas are nothing but sex cord stromal tumors. We have been seeing about the epithelial tumors, the germ cell tumors, and the third group is the sex cord stromal tumors. The fibromas belong there. They are inactive, unlike T comas, which is a counterpart, which is hormone producing. Fibromas are usually inactive. And let us remember the 1% rule. Only 1% of the fibromas are malignant, and the malignant counterpart is the fibrosarcoma. And only 1% is associated with Meigs syndrome. So we can imagine how rare the syndrome is. Only 1% of the fibromas are associated with Meigs syndrome. And once you remove the tumor, the life expectancy is as good as that of the general population. Second thing is ascites. What is the mechanism of ascites? It is not a malignancy to cause ascites. So why ascites in Meigs syndrome? There are so many hypotheses. It might be due to the irritation of the peritoneal surface, or it may be because the tumor size itself is big. More than 10 centimeter tumor can press upon the surrounding lymphatics and vessels. Or there might be an imbalance between the arterial blood supply to the large tumor and the venous and the lymphatic drainage. It might be responsible for the stromal edema and transudation, or it might be some hormonal stimulation or the torsion of the tumor. But the theory which has come to stay is it might be due to the release of mediators like activated complements, VEGF, histamines, FDP, that is fibrin degradation product from the tumor, leading to increased capillary permeability. So this is the one. The VEGF may be the culprit which is causing ascites in fibroma. Coming to the effusion part, Approximately 70% of the pleural effusions are right-sided, 15% is left-sided, and 15% bilateral. Now the question arises, why right pleural effusion? There are so many mechanisms for this also. The right paracolic gutter is found to be wider than the left paracolic gutter. So there may be more fluid collection in the right side. Another thing is the liver on the right side with its inspiratory and expiratory excursions going up and down. It might be creating some negative suctioning pressure so that more fluid is drawn up to the right MA diaphragm. And embryologically, the pleuroperitoneal sinuses, they remain open even in the adult. If, for example, if we inject methylene blue in the peritoneal cavity with ascites or fluid, it might take only 30 minutes for the methylene blue to reach the pleural cavity. So the pleuroperitoneal sinuses are open, which are more on the right side. So this may be some of the mechanisms why we have got 70% of the effusions on the right thorax. Incidence is only 1% of the ovarian tumors. That means it's very rare. It is very uncommon before the third decade, but progressively increases to peak in the seventh decade of life. What is the nature of the ascitic fluid and the pleural fluid? It can be either transudative or exudative. There are so many literature saying that transudative fluid is more, exudative fluid is more. But when Meigs, back in 1937, when he performed electrophoresis, the only thing he determined was whatever the fluid is there in the ascitic fluid, it is the same thing in the pleural fluid. It will be transudate or exudate. But now of late, even though I put up the study of 2015 saying that it is mostly exudative, now again new studies are coming up saying which is more transudate. Whatever it is, both the fluids are same in consistency. So Meek syndrome is a diagnosis of exclusion. Nobody can make a diagnosis on the first hand. Only after we rule out an ovarian malignancy, we can make a diagnosis of Meek syndrome. And the thing is, it will resolve. The pleural effusion as well as ascites will resolve once the ovarian tumor is removed. The most important differential diagnosis is malignant ovarian tumor. And remember, malignant ovarian tumor is much more common than Meek syndrome. So when we make a diagnosis of Meek syndrome, we should have confidently excluded malignancy. And as you know, malignant ovarian tumor, the effusion is usually exudative. And the diagnosis, abdominal ultrasound will demonstrate the ascites and of course ovarian tumor. Imaging also includes a CT scan of the chest, abdomen and the pelvis and MRI. There are many published reports that Meek syndromes can be there with elevated CA125 levels. It might be because of the mesothelial stimulation. And fluid should be sent for cytology. This is very important in distinguishing malignant ascites from Meek syndrome. And the definitive diagnosis is the post-operative resolution of the ascites and the pleural effusion, and of course, the histological confirmation of the tumor. The management, medical management includes paracentesis and thoracocentesis for ascites and pleural effusion, respectively. And the treatment of choice is exploratory laparotomy or laparoscopy and frozen section of the mass to be performed to confirm the benign nature of the mass. And in women of reproductive age, unilateral salpingo ovariotomy is a treatment of choice, whereas in postmenopausal women, it is hysterectomy plus bilateral salpingo ovariotomy. There are so many related terms like pseudo-Meek syndrome, pseudo-pseudo-Meek syndrome, atypical Meek syndrome. So let us just see what each one of these means. Pseudo-Meek syndrome is the same as Meek syndrome, except that instead of fibroma of the ovary, here other tumors like a teratoma or a stroma ovary or a Brenner tumor or granulosa cell tumor arises from the ovary. It could be even from a uterine or fallopian tube. For example, even when a fibroid presents with ascites and right-sided pleural effusion, it can be called pseudo-Meek syndrome. And advanced gastrointestinal and ovarian malignancy also, when it's associated with ascites and right pleural effusion, we call it pseudo-Meek syndrome. And pseudo-pseudo-Meek syndrome. Here, it is actually a case of systemic lupus erythematosus, which has as its part, there is pleural effusion and ascites as a part of SLE. And ovaries might be enlarged in these cases with an elevated CA125. That is pseudo-pseudo-Meek syndrome. It is also called Jalma syndrome. The third one is atypical Meek syndrome. Here it is same as Meek syndrome, but ascites is not there. So it is a ovarian mass plus right-sided flow deficiency. Here nobody knows the mechanism. Only very, very few case reports are there. Nobody knows the mechanism. How in the absence of ascites there can be right-sided pleural effusion. And to sum up, it is a benign lesion of the ovary with associated adverse effects. It can create panic amongst patients because mostly we will counsel them as it is a malignancy. Only after the resolution of the hydrothorax and the ascites as well as the histopathology, we will know whether the diagnosis is benign or malignant. And on a lighter note, when all the other speakers were finding it very difficult to finish within 10 minutes, I got a topic. I was finding it very difficult to stretch it to 10 minutes. And thank you so much, organizers, once again.
30 seconds more, Dr. Betsy.
Yes. Okay.
Thank you, Betsy, for that clear presentation to bringing up that most of the solid tumors, any solid tumors from uterus, fallopian tube, ovary, can cause Meek syndrome. When it is associated with fibroma, you call it as a Meek syndrome. Otherwise, you call it as a pseudo-Meek syndrome. This fibroma also can achieve huge size, even 15 to 20 centimeters. And it is always a diagnosis of exclusion. And you have to evaluate for the malignancy. And finally, after histopathology and everything, you reach the diagnosis. And that in reproductive age group, if you want to retain the reproductive function at other ovary, that is salpingo-ovariotomy, the ascites and the pleural effusion will disappear. Otherwise, you have to remove total hysterectomy with bilateral salpingo-oophorectomy. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Now, I request Dr. Anuj to introduce our next speaker, Dr. Ambukkani.
Thank you, Dr. Ravina. I'd like to welcome Dr. Ambukkani Subbiyan, who is a consultant, gynec oncologist, and robotic surgeon at Kovai Medical Center and Hospital, Coimbatore. Madam is a member of the Royal College of Obstetricians and Gynecologists and has finished a fellowship in gynecologic oncology and is certified by the European Society for Gynecologic Oncology. She is also executive member of EGOI and is the international representative from South Zone, the RCOG. I welcome her for a talk on IOTS staging of ovarian malignancies. Over to you, madam.
Thank you so much to the organizers for giving me this opportunity. Is my screen visible to everybody and am I audible?
Yes, ma'am.
So, first of all, congratulations for this excellent program with so much importance to gyne-oncology topics. I think it's a fantastic initiative. So my hearty congratulations to the entire organizing team. My topic is IOTA rules, and I'm going to try and finish it as quickly as possible because we are running short of time, I see. So first of all, for the postgraduates, what IOTA is the definition goes by International Ovarian Tumor Analysis. So if you can know that much itself, you'll be able to write the introduction part, where a group of people and researchers and clinicians got together and created this initiative to bring about standardization and uniformity in the evaluation by ultrasound when a patient reports with an ovarian or an adnexal mass. Now, why was this first of all needed? If you get into clinical practice or even when you're evaluating your gyne-oncology outpatients, you will realize that when they come with an ultrasound, there are so many different types of reports you get. You get reports which are very, very brief and some on the other extreme, which are fairly extensive. And we also know that when a person has a mass, if she's presenting to you without an investigation, the first investigation that you write as a gynecologist is an ultrasound. Literally to the extent that now a transvaginal ultrasound can be considered as an extension of a per-vaginal examination. Therefore, it's the first choice of imaging for evaluating adnexal masses. But with the vast variety of reports that we see, you understand that a lot of radiologists are reporting on this, and there are no standardized descriptive terms. Therefore, we do not get to compare reports, based on what is the accuracy of ultrasound. We do not get to interpret it properly and have a fairly good diagnosis going in surgery. And therefore, we miss triaging tumors into the three main categories of ovarian masses, which are benign, borderline, and malignant. Therefore, ultimately what happens is patient management gets affected. A proper referral cannot be done, proper management cannot be planned, and therefore you have a patient which is lying on the operation table, you open up, you find that it looks malignant, and then you do not know what to do, you can't call for help because you're not adequately prepared. Now, I'll just give you, we've already gone through this in multiple talks across the through the day, but to just give you a nutshell of how it is managed is you have an option of conservative management, not doing anything at all and observing, or minimal access of fertility preservation if you think the mass is benign, isn't it? But if it's borderline or malignant, you have to go in surgically. The difference in borderline is you can consider fertility preservation in most of the cases unless they are postmenopausal. And you can even consider minimal access when the tumor, it can be safely removed through a laparoscopy or a robotic operation. Now, in malignancy, most patients or all patients need to be managed in a gyne-oncology center because there's level one evidence that better survival outcomes and with patients happen to patients who are operated in specialist hands in specialized centers which handle these patients on an everyday basis. And this is in comparison to surgery, which is done by general gynecologists and by general surgeons. So that, to give the background of that, so this problem is not just pertaining to India, it's pertaining to the whole world. And that's why this group of researchers, which are basically based out of Belgium, came out with an initiative and a research group and formed this International Ovarian Tumor Analysis Research Methodology. Now, as a postgraduate, I want to take you through these four parts of IOTA, which is for the first paper that got published was on the definitions that radiologists or gynecologists need to use when they are reporting. And after 5 or 6 years came the LR models or the logistic regression models, which help us to diagnose and triage these masses into benign, borderline, and malignant. And after 5 years came out the simple rules, which is the part that you need to focus on. And finally, the latest one that came out in 2015 is the EDNIX model. So I'm going to quickly talk about these four, but I will be giving more importance to the first one and the third one. So definitions, LR model, simple rules, and the EDNIX model. Now, this is a paper that you have to know down. It came out in 2000, and this was a consensus opinion by the IOTA group, which talks about the terms, definitions, and how to measure the mass even is given clearly in that paper. I'm going to just give it to you very briefly. Now, the definitions cover four important attributes of an adnexal mass. First of all, what a lesion is, what is a septa, how does the internal wall look, and how do you report cystic contents. On the other side, you also get definitions for what is a unilocular tumor, a unilocular with solid, multilocular, and so on, and ends with a solid tumor. Now, the terms, I talked about four terms. So first of all, the lesion is any part of the ovary or adnexal mass that is not considered to be physiological. When you look at septum, it's a thin strand of tissue running from one side of the cyst cavity to the other side. When you look at the internal wall, you have to describe it as smooth or irregular. Now, these are the three important terms that are supposed to be mentioned on your report. Now, I suggest you draw these diagrams because just looking at it, they will know that they will know what you're talking about. Then comes the description of the cystic contents. Now, this is another picture that you need to remember, which is given in that paper, which goes from what anechoic looks like to what low-level echogenic looks like to ground glass appearance, which is most commonly, or at least it's a diagnostic feature of endometriotic cysts. And finally, hemorrhagic, which happens to show up internal thread-like structures, which represent fibrin strands. And you also need to describe them as star-shaped or cobweb-like or jelly-like as you see it. The final internal content description is a mixed echogenic, which is most commonly seen in teratomas. So you have either blood and fluid or you have blood and calcifications, and this can also be seen in abscesses. Now, the second part of the IOTA definitions covers what is unilocular, multilocular, and solid, completely solid, along with the combination of solid elements in these. And it's important to know this because this is what the B rules and the M rules are based on. Now, unilocular cyst is a cyst without septa or solid parts. That's the definition, and that needs to come on your answer sheet. A normal ovarian stroma is not regarded as a solid part, and the diagrams here are simple representations of what a unilocular cyst needs to be. So a clear round or a clear circle. So black is fluid on ultrasound. Therefore, clear black circle and with multiple small black circles without any septae. A unilocular solid cyst is similarly a black circle with a solid component. If you have even one measurable solid component, it needs to come on your report as a unilocular solid cyst. Similarly, multilocular cyst. So multilocular cyst is a cyst with at least one septum, but should not have any solid components or papillary projections. And this is a multilocular cyst. You've got a bigger cyst and you've got a smaller cyst inside. Doesn't matter what the size of the cyst is, but if you've got multiple loculations and no solid areas, it's a multilocular cyst. So the next slide goes without any explanation. If you've got a multilocular cyst with one solid component at least, then it is called a multilocular solid cyst. Finally, a solid lesion. So if this means that any tissue which has got a high echogenicity, like for example, myomas or fibromas, then it is called a solid lesion. A normal ovarian stroma blood clot will not be classified as solid. Favoring presence of blood flow on Doppler is in favor of solid lesions. Now, that particular paper also tells you how to measure and quantify. For example, how to measure a septum, how to measure a solid area, how to count the number of septae and locules and report it on your final report, and how to measure ascites. As far as ultrasound is concerned, it's incomplete without doing a color flow Doppler. Therefore, the entire tumor has to be assessed with color flow Doppler. You can either report it as a quantitative assessment where you use the velocity of flow, the PI, RI, and the PSV, or a semi-quantitative assessment can be done and you give the scores, which is 1, 2, 3, 4 corresponding from no flow is 1 to 4, where it's highly vascular. Now, this is all going to be incorporated into the third part of my talk, which is the simple rules. Now, I told you that there were four parts to the four main parts to the IOTA research. The first was setting basic definitions. Now, based on these definitions, what the research group did was study people in thousands of patients across almost 50 centers all over Europe. And they saw, they tried to match ultrasound pictures with final diagnosis and final correlation. And then they came up with mathematical models. So far, there are two models that have been created because this aims at detecting malignancy on an ultrasound for proper referral and proper management. The models go by the number M1 and M2. So any woman who presented with an adnexal mass was evaluated with a TVS. That is the most important, with a TAS when needed, because when you have larger masses, you need to combine with an abdominal ultrasound and color Doppler. And multiple parameters were recorded and mathematical models were created. So I'm not going to talk about this so much, but you have to remember that this was compared with RMI and found to be reliable in predicting malignancy. Now the third part is, I'm going to just take 2 more minutes if I'm running out of time. The third part is the simple rules, which is the B and M rules. And this is the most important for a general gynecologist to diagnose and differentiate between benign and malignant. This has been validated. It is now in the Green Top guidelines as a proper validated method in comparison with RMI. And this is how the B rules and the M rules flow. Now, remember, I told you what a unilocular cyst is. And even if a unilocular cyst is there with a solid component, and if the component is less than 7 mm, it's probably a cyst adenoma. If you've got equistic shadows, if you've got a multilocular tumor without any solid areas and which measures less than 10 centimeters, and if there's no color flow on Doppler, they designate or stand for benign tumors. Now, M rules are exactly comparative, but on the other end of the spectrum. So if you've got an irregular solid tumor, instead of acoustic shadows, if you've got ascites, if you've got at least 4 papillary structures, if you've got irregular multilocular solid tumors, which are more than 10 centimeters and very strong blood flow, then you've got a malignancy on your hand. And pictorially, this would get you all the marks if you can just draw these diagrams, and if you can remember that IOTA is the green boxes with those diagrams and the red boxes with those diagrams, I think you'll score your marks. So how you interpret is, if you have at least one or more M features without any B features, it's malignant. If you have one or more B features in the absence of M features, it is benign. If you have a combination, or if you're not able to put it into any of these rules, it's unclassified. So what needs to be done next? You need to refer them to a specialist radiologist. And this is the simple way of diagnosing and managing these patients in the correct way. So simple, come down to my fourth point, simple rules as a triage test, plus a subjective assessment by an experienced ultrasonographer as a second stage test can equal a subjective assessment in all these masses, and this has the potential to improve the management of women. So finally, the IOTA EDNICS. Now this is a computerized or an applied algorithm which you can get as an app on your mobile phone or in your ultrasound machine itself. This is going on to the next level where they don't diagnose just benign, but they're trying to diagnose benign, borderline, stage one, stage two to four, and secondary metastatic cancers. How it works is multiple parameters which you enter into your ultrasound machine like this, and you get a result and a column chart which tells you where the highest risk lies. So your IOTA EDNICS model will actually tell you for this patient, when they've put in all the ultrasound features as well as the patient characteristics, the risk of malignancy is 95% in this particular patient, and you know you've got to refer her to her specialist center. So basically, IOTA is ultrasound evaluation of adnexal masses. You've got terms, you've got LR models, simple rules, and finally the adnex model. So you've got to understand, remember the terms and the simple rules. And I urge you to read these two papers, which was published in 2000 for the terms and definitions, and BMD 2010 for the simple rules.
Thank you, Dr. Anbukani, for emphasizing on the importance of standardization of ultrasound reports, especially when we are dealing with malignant ovarian tumors. However, emphasizing that this particular IOTA scoring helps to differentiate between benign and malignant tumors, and thereby helping us to sort out what sort of surgery we can offer to the patients. Thank you very much for your presentation. I hand over to the coordinators.
Thank you, Dr. Anbu. Can you please stop sharing the screen?
I thank chairpersons for their contribution. We will be moving forward with the... Thank you, Dr. Anuj and Dr. Nishi. Any other comments to make? Dr. Anuj and Dr. Nishi?
Yeah, I think the